You got it.
So welcome everyone to this very special edition of the Seleukid lecture series. I am Altay Coskun, together with Ben Scolnic, the co-host of this lecture series, and also the co-editor of the new book series, Seleukid Perspectives, which we are launching today. And we are launching it together with its first volume, Seleukid Ideology. And we have a third co-host today, which is our friend and colleague, Richard Wenghofer from Nipissing University. And I pass it all on to him.
Thank you, Altay, and thank you all for taking the time to be here today. I hope you'll find today's discussion on this new series and on this new volume to be as illuminating and as stimulating as we have found producing it. We've arranged the proceedings today in a format of three panel discussions made of three pairs of contributors, from the Seleukid Ideology volume. Each pair of contributors will provide us with a slightly different or somewhat divergent view on some specific aspect of the production, dissemination, and response to Seleukid royal ideology across the vast space and time of Seleukid history. The first panel will be on the question of the effectiveness of Seleukid royal ideology and will feature myself and Dr. Coskun, as we present slightly divergent perspectives on this particular question. Rabbi Dr. Ben Scolnic will moderate that panel. The second panel will be on Seleukid royal ideology in Babylonian contexts and will feature Drs. Anagnostou-Laoutides and Erickson, with Dr. Gillian Ramsey moderating. And our third and final panel will be on Persian and Jewish responses to Seleukid royal ideology and claims to political legitimacy. Dr. Stephen Harrison will present us with the Persian perspective, and Dr. Rabbi Ben Skolnick will provide us with a look at Jewish perspectives on this question. Dr. Germain Payen will moderate panel three. And so without further ado, I will turn things over to Deirdre Klokow, who is both a contributor and an editorial assistant for this volume, and without whose efforts this volume would certainly not have been possible. Deirdre.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. Good morning. It's very early here in Los Angeles. So it is my job today to walk you all through the structures and the main themes of the book and its contributors, to just give you a little bit of an introduction before we move on to the panels that will follow. So this volume, this wonderful volume that we've all worked so very hard on, is divided into five main sections, each of which explores a different aspect of or approach to Seleukid ideology. The whole volume, of course, is preceded by an introduction written by Richard and Altay that sort of lays out the main themes of the book. So the first section, on the formation of Seleukid dynastic ideology, contains contributions by Kyle Erickson, Eva Anagnostou-Laoutides, and Altay himself, each exploring the process of constructing dynastic ideology in response to or in tandem with local perceptions regarding the exercise and performance of legitimate power and its symbols. And the focus in this section is really on moving away a little bit from the perspectives of king and court towards regional groups, to take a look at a range of reactions to the expressions of Seleukid authority. The second section, Enacting Seleukid Kingship, contains chapters by Babbitt Edelman Singer, Stephen Harrison, Rolf Strutman, and Ben Skolnick, and it moves into the later years of the dynasty to consider how these later Seleukid kings continued this dialogue with the communities under their rule as needs and circumstances changed with the dynasty's ever-changing fortunes, and how the perpetuation of royal ideology was adapted, refined, and nuanced. So together, these first two sections of the volume focus on broader attempts by the dynasty to perpetuate an expression of its authority that was acceptable on some level in different regions and to different polities under their rule, as well as giving a wider sense of its reception. The remainder of the volume, though, hones in a little bit more closely on the gamut of specific reactions to the presence and articulation of Seleukid authority by different groups. Reactions which, as we all know, can range from sort of general indifference to a really outright outraged sense of violence. So in section three of the volume on resisting Seleukid authority, we have two chapters, one by Gillian Ramsey and one by myself, examining aspects of local resistance from the perspective of two very different case studies, one focused on rural spaces and one on the character of revolt in the Greek polis. The fourth section, reframing Seleukid ideology, contains contribution by Germain Payen, Ben Scolnic, and Aaron Almagor, and widens the lens through which Seleukid ideology and rule are considered, using it as a framework through which we can consider the experience and perspective of these regional groups and their particular sort of engagement with the world of Seleukid politics, literature, and propaganda. The fifth and final section, reassessing Seleukid ideology, returns to the wonderful editors of the volume, Richard Wenghofer and Altay Coskun, for two in-depth perspectives on the efficacy of Seleukid royal ideology. These two chapters are not always in agreement, as may not surprise any of us who know both of them, but together the nuances that each author brings to their examination really draws the reader to consider the complications that are inherent in expressions of loyalty or assent to Seleukid rule by different subjugated groups, and also to consider the tensions that exist between desires for political and cultural autonomy and the realities of existence within a kingdom where the interests of local elites, local power holders, can often align more closely with those of king and court than with the regions in which they are involved. So that's the book. At the heart of this volume, I think at the center of a lot of its arguments is a perspective which is becoming more and more central to the study of the Seleukids, and I think of the Hellenistic world in general. And that's the imperative to move away from the focus on the perspective of king and court and elites to the extent that evidence permits, in order to really understand the complex variety of reactions to and engagement with expressions and performances of Seleukid authority. And this is an understanding which I think and I hope will really permit us to more fully grasp the cohesion and longevity of the Seleukid kingdom through all of its many permutations and with the many varied and constantly changing local conditions, circumstances, and needs with which royal power was engaged. So this is the book in a nutshell. I hope it's whetted your appetite a little bit to read it once it's in your hands. Before we move on to the panels that have been organized today, I just wanna take a moment to sort of personally acknowledge Altay and Richard and Ben for everything that they've done to promote and encourage Seleukid scholarship and open intellectual discussion for scholars at every level. I was still a graduate student when I started working with Altay, and it can be difficult to find people willing to bring you into the conversation at that level. So something I'm personally very appreciative of. And I just wanted to thank Altay and Ben and Richard and say what a pleasure it was to work with them. And finally, I would like to, on all of our behalfs, extend a very sincere thank you to our wonderful contacts at Steiner, who've each gone absolutely above and beyond in helping us bring this volume to fruition. Katrina Studeman, Moritz Mueller, and Kristen Harder, we're so grateful for all of your efforts on behalf of this project. And I know that Altay and Ben are very excited for the future of the Seleukid Perspective series with you, which I know is going to be absolutely outstanding. And also an apology to anyone whose name pronunciation I just butchered. Very sorry about that. Okay, so I'm going to turn things over to our first panel, I think on the effect and efficiency of Seleukid ideology with Altay and Ben and Richard. Thank you.
Okay, so Altay and Richard, again, thank you for all your work in creating this volume. It's a real contribution to the field. If you've never edited a book like this, you have no idea how many different skills you need to reach publication. Patience and flexibility are at the top of those, but also, and Deirdre said this very nicely, it's an important quality, which is the capacity to see other points of view. which brings us already to the spirited debate that Deirdre mentioned between the two of you, Altay and Richard, about the efficacy of Seleukid ideology. So the study of rebellions against the Seleukid Empire has been the subject of several recent papers, all of which have advanced the discussion. Gillian Ramsey studies the polis as a unit that strives for independence. And Richard offers the thesis that the empire was always in a kind of parasitic relationship with states that always wanted to be independent. Altay has countered Richard by showing that there also was loyalty to and cohesion within the kingdom. So what I'd like to do is to ask Richard first to present his view, and then ask Altay to respond with his, and then we hope to have further questions and discussion. So Richard.
Thank you very much, Ben. Altay has imposed some rather strict time limits on us for laying out our arguments, so I'll do my best to try to keep it within those limits. My paper, my contribution was primarily methodological in orientation, aimed at how we sort of interpret Greek civic decrees honoring Seleucid kings. I read these decrees against the backdrop of comments found in Plutarch, Polybius, and Pausanias, who all note that such decrees were sometimes proffered disingenuously and sometimes could even mask tensions, if not outright hostility. I also read them against the backdrop of what I would say is a kind of high level or high frequency of revolt, at least 17 before 150 BCE, some of which were in fact nearly fatal, to conclude that perhaps the decrees, these honorific decrees, are not quite what they seem to be. I therefore take a closer look at three specific decrees, OGIS 222, 223, and 229, and I conclude that these decrees can be read as acts of resistance in their own right, where the public royal persona is leveraged to curb or otherwise limit the encroachment of royal authority into the polis. I then go on to argue that weaponizing the king's royal persona against him in this way was one of the few strategies available to the polis when confronted by the overwhelming superior military power of the kings. Finally, my paper addresses, of course, the question of the effectiveness of Seleukid royal propaganda in compelling loyalty. My conclusion, my ultimate conclusion, is that Seleukid power coheres as long as it does, not because it engendered some kind of sort of warmth or loyalty on behalf of the subjects or on the part of Seleukid's subjects, but largely for other reasons. Those other reasons, of course, I don't go into in this particular paper. That will be the subject of yet another project. And so I hope I've kept it within the time limits. I will turn things over to Altay.
Well, thanks, Richard. You know, no one suffers more than I from the time limits that I tend to impose. And yet I want to take the time to thank you in particular, because I have enjoyed cultivating my disagreement with you over the past couple of years, you as a realist, I as a constructivist, and we trying to make sense of very important chapters of the past and sometimes present, trying to understand the workings of power within a kingdom, a kingship of the Seleucids over a vast territory in a world that is shaped by violence. My point of view, or the starting point that I had, was that you cannot hold together such a territory, even a much smaller kingdom, without methods of making rule and even certain levels of exploitation palatable, acceptable, and even to a certain degree advantages to the people. So, with all of that, I try to circumscribe ideological communication, because every speech act, every kind of interaction between the king and the court on the one hand, and the subject, its elite, cities, or dynasts on the other hand, is kind of ideological communication. And I think that this very explicitly and in many ways try to justify, try to explain as advantages the rule of the king over the subjects. And I then went further and I claim that many subjects really wanted to believe in these messages, in fact, even form part in phrasing these messages, in developing these messages, many of them to their own advantage. So that's the underlying idea of my paper, though the theoretical background I have actually explored much more in a different paper that is appearing elsewhere. For the present volume, I wanted to concentrate on the notion of loyalty, or rather on showing that there were many cases of loyalty that were not coerced. Babylon, the city of Babylon, is the prime example that I pursue, but I added a couple of other dynasts that show in the time of the weakness of the king, of the center of power, they showed loyalty. They took risks in order to defend the rule of the king. Part of the reason is that they themselves benefited tremendously being part in kind of this royal enterprise. So that's in a nutshell what I've tried to argue, and I leave it at that for now.
Okay, all right, so let me try to turn this into a kind of a discussion between the two of you. Let's do it this way. Can't you both be right? That is, I'm in the happy position of seeing truth in both of your arguments. At any moment, on any day, in any year, there were different responses. So I want to give you one example, the example that I happen to know best. It's 2 Maccabees 4, and Antiochus IV visits Jerusalem. I'm going to quote, "He was sumptuously greeted by Jason and the Jerusalemites, and he was brought into the city with a torchlight parade and shouts of applause." That's about 172. A few years later, there'll be the most famous rebellion against the same king, Antiochus IV. So I'm just saying, can't there have been efficacy? And as Altay is the torchlight parade, right? And Richard is the rebellion. So why I when I read both of your papers, I get each of you. I think you're both right. Why can't there be a spectrum? Why is this an argument rather than showing that there were different responses at different times? And so I don't quite get this as a disagreement, because I think you can both be methodologically right, reading right, and but there are different cases. The Seleukid Empire lasted for a long time and was very widespread. And you know, so what I've tried to say to both of you in emails is, you know, we should come up with a typology or a spectrum or something of all these different kinds of responses. So that's what I would throw back to each of you.
Can I respond to that? I think Ben, you make a very good point. This is an excellent observation. I think that over time, as this work unfolded, Altay and I came closer together with respect to this disagreement. Certainly, I am not claiming that you know, resistance was omnipresent, was universal. I'm simply suggesting that the evidence that's typically used to suggest loyalty among individual polities, honorific decrees or acquiescence, right, are deeply problematic, right? A weaker power can acquiesce or even ally itself with a superior power for all kinds of reasons that have nothing to do with warmth of feeling or loyalty in any sense. These loyalties can be driven by pragmatic interests, and as those interests shift and change on the ground, loyalties shift and change. A perfect example might be, as an example, I might point to the career of Seleukos I himself. As Altay quite rightly notes in his paper, he recovers Babylon after his stint under Ptolemy, with a handful of troops, because he was largely preferred there to the Antigonid kings. This same Seleukus, of course, was killed by his own soldiers in 281 BCE. So we can see how attitudes and feelings about Seleukus shift and change according to context. My argument is simply that we cannot take the inscriptional evidence or the mere fact of acquiescence themselves as at face value, as evidence at face value.
Thanks, Richard. I find it very important that you started by saying that through discussion, through exchange of arguments, looking at the evidence together, we have narrowed down our disagreement tremendously over the past couple of years. And so there is little left in your article to which with which I would disagree. Largely, I would agree with your overall thesis, the difficulty of proving loyalty, of proving honesty, and the sources that we draw on have problems. They do not fully reveal what's on the minds of the people who said so. At this level, I fully agree with you, and I agree with Richard that there was loyalty, there was resistance and revolt, and it would be good to work on kind of a scale and to try to typologize and classify the different kinds of revolts and so on. My emphasis, however, is on my observation, or well, partly it's still a claim. I give examples, but I have not yet given full evidence for this, is that the Seleukids have wrongly been, well, accused of being weaklings, and that the normalcy under Seleukid rule was coercion or revolt. Whereas I would claim the Seleukids had a very high appeal for their subjects, that most of the time subjects were loyal or at least did not question the rule. And if we compare the known cases of revolt, I think compared to the time of the Seleukid rule and compared to the size of the territory that they held sway over, this is much less than, say, for the Ptolemies or the Antigonids. So that is my claim. And I try to give a few examples, such as the very important city of Babylon, which very often has been presented as accepting Seleukid rule reluctantly, although our sources say explicitly the opposite, and our sources are very variegated, some referring to them showing loyalty when they were under attack by external enemies or by, say, a usurper, and also expressing their loyalty and their acceptance of Seleukid ideology and supremacy. So I would really like to bring about or to emphasize and to emphasize the shift of perspective which has been taking place over the past couple of years, also particularly through research that's been done within our network, the Seleukid Study Group, that show that the Seleukid kingdom, at least in the first 150 years, was arguably the strongest, the mightiest of all the successor kingdoms. And still it lived on, though the last, after 150, for sure it was much weaker and did not came out of the sequence of revolts as well as the Ptolemies did by the later second century. So that's my overall perspective, trying to explain why I feel it, in this time of the scholarly discussion, it is well advised to emphasize to loyalty over disloyalty and stability. And let us add the notion of resilience, the Seleukids' ability of regaining ground after an occasional local revolt by drawing on so many allies and loyal subjects within their kingdom. Is that clear enough? I try to be short and not speak too long.
Okay. Let me just try a little bit more. So Richard, when I read your paper, I feel political cynicism, right? That is, I feel, you know, the Arab street, as I think you once did in a lecture or something, you were showing some pictures. And what I get out of your paper is they never really were loyal. you know, and your word parasitic is saying they were always parasites. So even though in these decrees they may be showing loyalty, come on, it's not real. They didn't really mean it. They were just being, oh, I don't know what your word was, obsequious or acquiescent or something like that. Whereas I would say that Altay was saying, no, some of that was real. And just one more quick point. I was very impressed with Gillian's paper for this book, where she emphasizes the polis. And so because of her, I'm picturing an assembly in one particular city. And I'm picturing at this assembly, there are some people who are really loyal at this one given moment. And there's some people who are saying, these guys are parasites. They're creeps. We got to rebel. And the other one says, no, they're good to us. So that's what I'm trying to say, that at any given moment, you could both be right.
Yeah, no argument for me. I think any demographic, of course, is variegated. There are a variety of opinions and points of view based on the relation in which they stand to the central power and to the central authority, right? Those are going to be the various factors that condition questions of loyalty, which of course can shift and change as has been noted already over time. So yeah, I think your point is well made.
I again also have to agree, and I draw explicitly on Gillian's paper, also in my paper, especially on her section on amnesia. I was really impressed by the strategy, and it seems to be a more common pattern that even after war, or say a revolt, and after the use of force, there was an inclination on both sides to forget about the violent past and rebuild trust by looking into a non-violent future, in which loyalty and mutual benefit may grow by leaving violence behind, also in through the Speech Act, by trying to completely avoid it. And I think I added to the argument in my paper that when you look at the ambassadors, those that then pay homage to the king, they are barely ever, or in all the examples that I remember, they are not the defeated generals, but rather they are those people, Ben, whom you mentioned, who are in that city, who had always been more loyal to the king or seen advantages of working with the king. So they had a really higher potential to find the trust of the king, whereas the king would do his best to woo these people and make them feel welcome and honored, esteemed, and give them something to take back to show their own fellow citizens, hey, you can have a better life with this king. Trust me and let us trust the king and live in peace. I think that was more than normalcy. Well, if not for the mere reason of survival, because most cities would not have the resources of embarking in endless fights with the king. So acquiescing under the rule of one king, also knowing that there are other rival kings who would love to take over as soon as that one king withdraws, in many situations would have been the best thing to do. And here then is, I think Richard would still agree largely to what I've just said. The minor difference is that I claim an inclination to believe then the new wording, to want to believe in this good relation, in the goodness of the king. Whereas Richard is then a little bit more cynical, where, well, I don't want to paraphrase you because you are here and you can do it yourself, but do you think I have described the remaining discrepancy between us well?
More or less. I would hesitate to use the word cynical so much as skeptical. Skeptical in the sense that I don't think the evidence, such as it is, can tell us that, right? I don't think it can provide us with that kind of granularity of detail. We need to look at other types of evidence. We need to look in other places for when we're trying to gauge questions of loyalty and stability and that kind of thing. We have to look at what individual polities actually do. And even there, we are on shaky ground because It's not always clear why they're doing what they do, right? Certain stakeholders in a community can acquiesce in the demands of a king because it serves their own interests, right? These can be purely pragmatic considerations, as you yourself pointed out, and as I are just now, and as I argue in the paper, you know, when confronted by the sort of overwhelming military might of the Seleukid kings, acquiescence is simply a survival strategy, right? And there aren't a lot of other options available. So the kind of negotiation of power relationships takes place on a kind of tilted or heavily skewed field, right? It's impossible for us to gauge the sensibilities of the kind of a general population in a polis, let's say, in that particular context. And when even the honorific decrees themselves are couched in a language that really, as I argue in this paper, that really have as their primary purpose or objective maintaining the kind of autonomy and freedom of the polis. When that sort of comes to the fore as their objective, we have to then sort of understand those inscriptions and those efforts, those diplomatic efforts, in the context of the comments made, as I said, by Plutarch, Polybius, and Pausanias, right? It injects sufficient skepticism into the narrative that we're really not in any position to say one way or the other what is motivating these kinds of honors or honorific decrees.
Okay, well, thank you both for that wonderful discussion. And since we've been praising Gillian, let's call on Gillian for our next panel number two, which she'll introduce.
Oh, thank you very much. So we now zero in on Babylonia, and we're going to be hearing from the authors of two chapters dealing with Seleukid kingship and Babylonian tradition. So Kyle Erickson is the professor of classics at the University of Wales, St. David, and he wrote a chapter entitled Royal Propaganda and the Creation of Royal Status for Seleukos I. And Ava Anagnostou-Laoutides is the associate professor in the Department of History and Archaeology at Macquarie University. And she wrote a chapter for the volume called The Kingship, that's ship with a capital S, of the Seleukids, an alternative paradigm for the anchor symbol. So thank you very much, Kyle and Ava, for being with us today. I have an initial question for you, which will hopefully give you a chance to quickly summarize your argument, but zeroing in, both of you deal with symbols and their potency for establishing Seleukid kingship in people's eyes. So what I'd like to ask you first is, if you could select one or two symbols that you deal with in your chapter and tell us how you analyze them and what you do with your analysis of those symbols. I don't know. Kyle, would you like to go first?
I guess so, because somebody has spotlighted me so first. I think we both deal with the anchor, and Eva deals with it far better than I do, and actually answers a whole number of questions I have had for a mini number of years on it. But for me, it is that symbol of Apollo and that ability of the Seleucids to weave symbols that are multivariant into narratives that speak at a number of levels. So that speak to a Greek audience, that could speak to a Babylonian audience, could speak to an Iranian audience, within the same contextual framework, so that they communicate the same type of idea to each of those objects, even if they're picking up on different local traditions, but they're sending the same message across different audiences. And they seem to have an ability to pick up particular symbols, and I'll turn over to Ava there, that do speak to all of those audiences. And I think that seems to be a particular strength of the dynasty in the face of what Altay and Richard have talked about. I remain entirely agnostic on where I come down on my agreements and disagreements with them, because I think it's almost impossible to discern. But I think there is an attempt to pick symbols that assuage both of what Richard and Altay have been doing from a dynastic perspective.
Hey, Ava.
Thank you, Kyle, for explaining your paper so eloquently. And please, I beg your patience, because it is 1:20 after midnight in Melbourne. So I feel that my ability to argue, as it were, is dwindling fast. But let me try and focus on the symbol that I chose. For many years, it was the anchor that attracted my attention, and how the Seleucids have been using the anchor in their coins to promote their dynasty and their ability to rule. So what I've done in my paper is, like, I thought, fine, obviously I need to deal with coins. Let me roll up my sleeves and try and see what are the main arguments that try to explain that symbol on the coins of Seleukos I. The arguments already put forward, very clever, very refined arguments, just didn't cut it for me, because I thought, at the time of conquering Babylon, why would he really want to remind people of other naval victories, victories that he possibly achieved under Ptolemy, or in his capacity as somebody else's ally? So I thought, maybe we need to turn our attention elsewhere. How much would the anchor have to say to the local populations? And the more I engaged with Babylonian literature and generally Near Eastern literature, the more surprised I was to find examples of Near Eastern rulers and Babylonian rulers presenting themselves as captains of the ship of state, being proud of anchoring their ships in important ports, and basically enjoying divine favor for doing just that. So on top of that, it seems that although we don't have the typical Mediterranean anchors that the Seleucids are using on their coins in the Near East, where sailing is mainly in rivers, they can still appreciate the concept of security that anchoring the ship of state can offer. And in Babylon, this is particularly associated with cultic observations for Marduk and Nabu. So that was the basis of my argument, trying to say that, look, this ideology was not just centering on Babylon, but was familiar to people outside the city itself. Certainly under Nebuchadnezzar, was really popular across Babylon's sphere of influence. Is someone talking to me, or am I talking?
No.
Mm-hmm. Or someone has left their microphone open. So anyway, my that would conclude my summary.
Yeah.
What I would like to say, however, Altay and the others speak so far about leadership and the Seleucids, especially Seleucus the First, ability to command support and loyalty, is that maybe, although in my paper I've been focusing on the Near Eastern side of things, maybe we should also take into account the intellectual debates about kingship and leadership in 4th century Greece. And having engaged with philosophers for quite some time now. I think Aristotle has an awful lot to say about types of kingship and types of benefaction that are absolutely crucial for commanding people's admiration and people's loyalty. So that would be my contribution to this discussion. And I hope Kyle can you know, retort.
Oh, thank you very much. So Ailey, you were leading me into the next question I have for you both. If you can briefly say, what for you was the most surprising, or shall we say most pleasing, observation or conclusion that you came to while you were working on your chapters? The role of serendipity in scholarship. I'm just curious, what was that lightning bolt moment while you were writing where you saw something new that was exciting?
Kyle, would you like to answer first?
I'm going to say Eva's paper, because I've been bothered by the anchor and never been satisfied at all with any of the explanations before this. But I'm also going to say we were due, or at least Altay had given me an extension for the to get my chapter until about the 8th or so of January. And I was rewriting about the transitions of power and how that's a moment fraught while watching the January 6th in the US. And that, I think, has informed a lot of my thinking about that moment where risk of rebellion becomes serious and how much transition in that early phase of rule becomes important.
Thank you very much for your good words. For me, yes, Altay's patience was absolutely critical in getting to the end of this paper, as well all the fantastic people out there that are experts in Near Eastern languages and texts, and were really keen to provide me with the latest editions. But the light bulb moment happened when I realized how important sailing to the Gulf was, not just for legendary Near Eastern kings, but also for Alexander and Seleukos, that they actually had hands-on experience of sailing the Tigris and the Euphrates all the way to the Persian Gulf. Immediately I thought, these people saw themselves as ship captains, as naval commanders going through a land that was harboring similar legends and myths. So yes, that's where the two people came together, the two ideologies interacted or had the chance to interact. So I'm not completely mad.
No, of course not. Well, thank you.
Well, there was quite a time in, you know, for a few months I thought, yes, it's not exactly straightforward, but yeah.
So you both in your chapters address the role of myth-making, or shall we say building a narrative for the establishment of Seleukid power. So since you both concentrate on the Babylonian region, what are the particular Babylonian mythoi or narratives that you are working with in your chapter? So you both have mentioned this, but just to draw it out a bit more, and maybe if you can respond to each other about where there are overlaps or comparisons. Kyle, would you like to go first?
I was going to suggest Eva go first.
Or Eva go first, sure. Eva.
Look, thank you. The mythological pattern that I focused on was the cosmic battle of Marduk with Tiamat, mm-hmm. where, as a result of this battle, kingship is established at the divine level, and of course, is then replicated on Earth, where the king emulates or is the trusted champion of the god. He's now taking the baton from the god ruling his people with the justice inspired to him by the divine sphere. And I thought that, you know, this would appeal to Seleukos and his Greek subjects, because, well, even when you read the Republic, it's all about emulating the divine virtue. So I couldn't see, yes, the cosmic battle immediately brings Hesiod and that kind of literature to mind, which of course would not be unfamiliar to them at all, but it is also a useful tool to relate to their new subjects and build bridges with them. And it doesn't make them less or more Greco-Macedonian. Yes, that would be the mythical pattern that I focused on.
And Kyle?
For me, and it always feels slightly weird because people are talking about someone they know, but Alexander as a mythological pattern for that early set of successors. And I do mean that that's a mythological pattern, and that Alexander is both taking that cosmic role as well as that personal role, and that the successors are both trying to emulate, surpass both him and the gods at the same time, and that they're putting themselves in a fragment that they are legitimate heirs within that context in all that that means. And that I think that mythologizing about Alexander starts nearly instantaneously, and that the successors are having to respond to a mythologized human who they all walked around with and fought numerous battles with. And that creates an interesting tension in that creation of how they do that, both in that sort of divine context as well as human context. And I think kings are forced to straddle that human divine boundary in a different way post-Alexander, particularly in the Greek world.
And I suppose it's a nice coincidence that Alexander died in Babylon. So things are very immediate there in terms of the quick creation of a narrative that deals with his legacy and what he had done.
And I think Babylon is probably very important in ways that we probably lost at the end of Alexander, and how much Babylon was probably aimed to be that center of a new empire for Alexander that disappears in the early wars of succession as well. Mm-hmm. And that it plays a really prominent role in that creation of early Hellenistic mythology, for lack of a better term.
Yeah, I'd like to say I disagree, but I totally agree with you. So yes, in many ways, I see Seleukos as a Pamvasileas, and maybe even the Pamvasileas that Alexander didn't manage to be when his troops kind of refused to follow him to the Ganges. It's like, you know, at this point, you no longer have our trust. We want to go back. But then Seleukos comes and he is able to command enough support to be made king in Babylon eventually.
I would agree with that. Although Richard has just added a new idea of making sure that I look at all of Seleucus's army in murdering Seleucus and how much that is that as well, rather than it being an internal rebellion to another elite individual. But the extent of support there is in the army becomes an interesting question there as well.
Well, thank you very much. I do want to make sure that if anyone in the audience has a question for you, that they have an opportunity to ask. So you can raise your hand, or else type it into the comment, the chat section, and I can read it out if anyone does have a question for Kyle and Ava.
While you are thinking about your questions, may I just throw in into this Babylonian panel a big thanks to our friend Letitia Graslan-Thomas from Nancy, who was very supportive of all the papers with Babylonian content. So the quality of the book would not be what it is without her input.
Absolutely. Thank you. And thank you, Gillian, for the questions and for giving structure to this panel.
Yes, thank you very much, Gillian. Richard.
Well, thank you, Carla. I don't see any questions, so I'll pass it on to the next presenter or the next moderator.
Which is Gemma?
I forget who it is.
Gemma Payen?
That's me. Well, hello, everyone. I will first join everyone else in thanking those who made this book publication possible. So mainly Altay Coskun and Richard Wenghofer, and also Deirdre Klokow, and there are others, of course. So this panel will be about visions of empire, Achaemenids, and Jews. I will introduce two contributors, Stephen Harrison and Rabbi Ben Scolnic. So Stephen Harrison is a lecturer in ancient history at the Swansea University, Wales, and he wrote about Antiochus at Daphne and Xerxes at Sardes, comparative perspective on the Seleukid vision of empire. Before I go to Ben Skronik, maybe Stephen, you want to maybe do a little summary of the main points of your contribution?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. And I'd echo all the thanks that people have said to all the people involved in this already as well. All right, main thing. Okay. What I'm interested in, I guess, is trying to break down the traditional chronological boundaries that we divide the ancient Near East into. And so the paper that I've written in this volume kind of comes out of some broader work that's about thinking about the Achaemenids, Alexander, and the Seleukids together, rather than drawing kind of arbitrary distinctions between them. And I guess what I do in this paper is I set the parade at Daphne in the 160s against Xerxes' exit from Sardis in the 480s. And what I'm interested in there is, what do they tell us about the messages that were being communicated to local subjects about the nature of empire? And I guess the reason, in big picture terms, that I'm interested in doing this and why I think it's valuable is I think situating what the Seleukids do against what the Achaemenids do help us work out what is distinctively Seleukid, what is different, what is new, what is unique. And I think there is sometimes a little bit of a tendency, not in this group, but outside of this group, to talk about Hellenistic kingship as though it's all the same, or to talk about Near Eastern kingship as though it's all the same. And I think this kind of comparative approach lets us kind of draw out some of the distinctions, some of the differences. And I guess the big point I make in the paper is that Xerxes and Antiochus are doing fundamentally different things in how they are presenting their empire. So yeah, there's a quick snapshot.
Thank you, Stephen. And the next contributor is Dr. Rabbi Ben Skolnik, who is a rabbi, as I said, also a scholar, and who has taught among others at the Yale University and the University of Connecticut. His contribution is about Star Wars, how a Julian author in the 160s BCE transformed a Ptolemaic view of Hellenistic history into a theology for his time. So Ben, if you want to...
Okay, I don't know if I can be as brief as Stephen, which was great. But let me take a couple of minutes to present what I was doing. But it sort of fits with what Stephen was just talking about, but not from a scholarly point of view of not seeing all these empires as so distinct, but from the point of view of one people, the Jewish people living in these times, and they saw a succession of kingdoms. But going back to Assyrians, Chaldeans, Persians, Macedonians, Ptolemies, and Seleukids, and they had a problem. The problem was a theological one, because they were monotheists and they believed in the destiny of their people. Well, and they also believed in this thing called reward and punishment. So they created this huge model, and the model goes back to a king that most of you have never heard of named Menasheh, who lived in the 600s BCE, and he did what was considered to be terrible sins. And the sins were so terrible that there was this curse that was coming down that even a good king named Josiah could not repel. And so that's why in the early 500s BCE, there were exiles and then the temple was destroyed. But then when the temple was destroyed, there was a prophet and his name was Jeremiah. He said, okay, there's gonna be 70 years of exile and then everything's gonna be great. Well, there were around 70 years of exile and they did go back, but things were not so perfect. They were, instead of being under the Chaldean Babylonians, they were under the Persians. So their subjection to other empires kept going. But it was relatively okay. And then you hit a crisis in the 160s BCE, and you have this guy, Antiochus IV, who I was referring to before, and there's this terrible situation, and they need to recast all of that. And so these geniuses, there's either one or more, came up with a new grid, and they reinterpreted that 70 years to 70 weeks of years. And they said, okay, it's 490 years, and it's almost over. And this bad stuff is happening, right? But this is going to be the end of days, and then everything is going to change. So in these remarkable chapters, 10 through 12 of the book of Daniel, which were written in this time, right around 166 BCE, right in the middle of the crisis, they were saying the crisis is going to be over in a certain number of days, going to this chronology, going back with the 490 years. But they come up with this incredible thing, especially from monotheists, and that it's that each of these kingdoms that we're talking about, each of these empires has what I call divine avatar. I watch the movies too. And so up in heaven, there are battles going on that I like to call, because each one of them is called a Sar, I like to call them Sar Wars. And so I'm mixing little Avatar and little Sar Wars. I got a lot in there. So the reason why, say, Alexander has won is because his Sar in heaven, his prince, his divine avatar is winning the battle in heaven. And then if the Ptolemies are winning, right, it's because their avatar is winning. But these avatars are fighting each other. And there's another avatar named Michael. You've heard of the angel Michael. This is where the first time he was ever named. And so he's fighting these guys too. Now if you say, wait a minute, if you've got divine avatars fighting in heaven, is that monotheistic anymore? Well, I don't know. It's a good question, sort of, because it's all part of this huge plan that God is letting these Sars have their wars for a certain amount of time. But then at a certain point of time, that time is going to be up. So what I talk about in this paper is the idea that here is an incredibly contemporaneous, right in the middle of the situation. This isn't some Roman historian talking hundreds of years later. It's somebody living through it, trying to cope and trying to figure out a way that fits his theology the best he can.
Thank you very much. And you talked about succession of empires. I think that's an important feature that sort of link your two contributions. How did the translation, well, the succession of empires is a way or tool to question the very idea of empire and how we see it, our modern vision of it now, and how the ancient people saw it. So if I can maybe formulate it as questions more precisely, maybe for Stephen, maybe if what differences you see between Xerxes parade, Xerxes display of power in 480, that's what difference you make between that and say Ptolemaic or Roman triumph and Ptolemaic displays that happened in the same time that really make you. This new approach, a different contribution?
Yeah, I mean, I guess in the paper, I don't really think too much about Ptolemies and the Romans. But where I see a distinction between the Seleukids and the Achaemenids is in the way that they deal with what you might call a hierarchy of empire, that Xerxes has a very clear hierarchy in the physical spatial display at Sardis, where he is in the center, there are Persians around him, and then a mix of everybody else. And that's something that's reflected in the iconography that one sees at Persepolis and that kind of thing. And I guess I argue that the Seleukids take a different approach, and that under Antiochus, that kind of very clear kind of pre-existing ethnic or local cultural identity, however you want to talk about it, those pre-existing identities are very important in the Persian displays and are less important in the Seleukid displays. And the big argument that I would advance is that, and this is partly a result of Seleukid colonization policy, alongside being Jewish or being Babylonian or being Median or whatever it is, in the Seleukid Empire, people can become Seleukid as well. They can be inhabitants of the great Seleukid cities, and they take on those kind of names. And I think that that's a distinction between the Achaemenid period, where the Achaemenids are very clear, Persians, Babylonians, Medes, they retain their pre-existing identity. And I think that that's where things are going in a slightly different direction. And I guess in the paper I explore, or I start to think a little bit about whether that Seleukid identity is distinctive enough to be meaningful and impactful.
Thank you. And for Dr. Skolnik, as you said, the Book of Daniel is supposed to happen, well, the main character is supposed to have lived under Babylonian and Achaemenid rule. So is there any hint at how Judeans differentiated or did not differentiate Achaemenid rule from Ptolemaic or Seleucid rule in the 160s in this book?
Well, it sort of jives with what Stephen was just saying. Yeah, everything was okay until the present time, and until this guy's present time. So you're right. The main figure, Daniel, is a fictitious character living in the 500s under Chaldean and Persian rule. But that's a fictitious character who's made up, I would say, not everybody would agree, by a person living later, even if there were earlier forms of Daniel and earlier texts. But there is a qualitative difference between everything that's gone on so far and, as Stephen was, I think, saying, you know, what's going on now in the 160s and the attempts that are being made, which at least some Jewish people found to be threatening to their identity.
Thank you. And I don't know if you have, well, anyone have questions for them, and you have questions for each other. Maybe. Yeah, we have Andy Sherwood.
Hi, I have a question on architecture, actually, which wasn't covered, but it sort of is on the borders of a couple of the talks. And Seleucid architecture traditionally has been very difficult to identify. I think there's been a little bit more work, and I'm definitely not an expert in this, where there seems to be some innovation in traditional architectural practice. And so this is sort of Stephen sort of talking about groups being able to become one together. I don't know if the architecture is a reflection of that or not, but Altay or God, just a second, Ava or Kyle might have something to say, but I just sort of think of Alexander, what he starts with, naming cities like his father did after himself, Alexander building temples, you know, not Ephesus because they wouldn't put an inscription on, but Priene because they did an inscription. And then what Augustus does later with that and uses architecture really to speak about the power of the ruler. And the Seleucids seem to be downplaying that a little bit. I just don't know if that's true or not. So I just throw that out to people who know much more than I do.
Yeah, if you don't mind me coming back, I think it's something that I've tried to look at, and I think we're, you know, hindered by the lack of evidence, particularly in my case, thinking about royal ideology. We just don't have the Seleukid palaces in the way that we've got the Achaemenid Persian palaces as a point of contrast. I think you do see signs in somewhere like Iconium of a mixture of different building traditions within the city. So you have Babylonian style architecture alongside Greek style architecture. And I would imagine that that is part of this kind of attempt to create something that looks visually distinctive and visually different within the Seleukid Empire to what you get in Antiquated Macedonia, for example, and thus a way of distinguishing between people. But certainly I don't know enough of the evidence, and I'm not sure how much of the evidence there is to kind of substantiate it, at least with regard to kind of some of the royal ideology elements.
Okay. Altay, surely you've got something to say.
Unfortunately not. I did not engage very much with architecture. And when I heard a lecture or read an article, I was not very perceptive of what was described as particularly Seleukid. But I can refer you to the works of Professor Winfried Held. I think he's professor at Marburg University in Germany. And he wrote some important articles apart from the Iconium project, which I think also has some publications trying to identify it. For the visibility, I would lean on urban, on cities, impressive urban infrastructure under the name of Seleukid rulers, paired with coin issues showing the Seleukids. And I do not know what else, probably a lot we would have to imagine when it comes to the royal cults, also paintings and sculptures of the kings, of which we do not have so much left though. So I'm sorry that I can't go further here, but if I'm not sure if Eva, you wanted to ask a question or rather help us respond to Andy.
I think the latter. I see Kyle also has his hand up. Would you like to go first, Kyle?
I actually had a question, so I'll let you go.
On this, yes, in this case, let me go first, if you don't mind. What I wanted to contribute to this discussion is this. We do know, thanks to Invernizzi and Messina and that team that were doing the excavations in Seleukia on the Tigris, that we have indications of Seleukid elements or Greek elements being combined with local elements on the many seals that were found in Seleukia. And now when we come towards the Mediterranean to Antiochia and the other capital of the Seleukids, yes, we have nothing literally from the Hellenistic city, but the Roman mosaics that very much seem to replicate imagery of Hellenistic origin seem to entertain myths that are not exclusively Greek. For example, these mosaics show a particular tendency to depict Tethys, sometimes with the ocean, mostly without the ocean. There have been a few arguments that this Tethys is more or less the Greek version of Tiamat. So about architecture per se, I wouldn't be able to enlighten you more, but in terms of how they seem to incorporate in their urban spaces, Eastern elements or non-Greek elements, I think that would go toward saying, yes, this is what they were doing.
Thank you very much. Maybe Kyle, you have a question?
I have a question that wasn't related, but it was one of the things that both Stephen and Ben had said about that creation of Seleucid citizenship and something new coming across that's fostered a relation in a reaction within Hellenistic Judaism. And I'm wondering how much we may have underplayed the importance of Antioch becoming a Greek city as part of the cause of that reaction. Not necessarily the cultural changes that Maccabees and outline, but the fact that citizenship as part of a collective whole rather than as a Jewish.
Do you mean Antioch or Jerusalem?
Sorry, Antioch being renamed, becoming Jerusalem.
Or Jerusalem becoming Antioch.
Jerusalem becoming an Antioch. Sorry.
No, but I don't think we downplay that. We think that it might have been a vivid reaction to that, but it doesn't feel like that's when the reaction happened. It feels like it was later. Look, this is a very vexed subject that a lot of us are working on really hard, and people have been working on really hard for a long time. So it's any question in here is important, but I'm not sure that was the thing. I think it might have been an accumulation of things, including just violence. Violence begets violence, but even that reaction took a while. When we talk about the Maccabees and everything, it there were stages of this thing. One of the things that I don't think Eric Gruen is right about is it's not the persecution did not begin immediately. And there are a lot of people who question to what extent was it a persecution. There's a lot of things still here up for grabs. But you might be right, and I think that's worthy of further consideration, that, combining this with the discussion we're having, let me just try to restate your question. If there was a thing, a political kind of thing, I'm always emphasizing the religious kind of thing. That's where I come from, right? But the political kind of thing, maybe we are downplaying, and that's worthy of more thought.
Can I build on that? Because I think from a slightly different angle, I think, Kyle, you're talking about the problem that I get to in my paper, which is I talk about Seleukid identity. And what I'm talking about there is a dynastic identity. And the question is whether one can conceive of that and whether people in the empire could conceive of that as a dynastic identity that bound them together, and they could think of the Seleukids as a dynasty, or whether people could only think of them as being a Greco-Macedonian dynasty. And the example I've got in my paper is that the core of the phalanx is described essentially as being Macedonian. It's armed like Macedonians and all of that. But actually, there's good reasons to think that some of those people in there are not Greek and Macedonian, but might come from the heartlands of the empire. Now, for those people, what they're doing when they're taking on this Seleukid identity is actually taking on the cultural markers of Greco-Macedonian identity. And I think in some sense, the renaming point that you're talking about plays into that as well. Could people see Antioch, the concept of Antioch, as being something that could bind everyone together and say, hey, yeah, we all live in Antioch, we're all Antiochians? Or do they see this as the imposition of a Greco-Macedonian framework? And of course, it can be both, and it can be different things for different people. But I think in creating, or as I see it, trying to create a dynastic identity, I think that's the problem that the Seleukids, for me, rub up against, is that the thing they come up with is not entirely distinctive because of the way it inevitably leans on Greek and Macedonian heritage.
Thank you very much. I think we are on the very important 20-minute mark, so maybe if there is still one or two questions or commentaries, and after that we can go to maybe all the questions for the first and second panel, which didn't have time for that.
Can I make a remark?
Sure.
That actually might lead into that, because I was just thinking about the kind of comparative element. One of the things, and it ties into what Altay and Richard were debating earlier on, one of the things I think that's interesting about the Seleukid Empire and the efficacy of legitimacy or ideology in the Seleukid Empire compared to the Ptolemies and the Antigonids is you're dealing with people who are fundamentally used to being part of an empire. And I think that changes things in terms of the response, not necessarily in, the Greek communities on the fringes, but certainly within Babylonia. and some of the other heartland communities. I just wonder if that's something we should be thinking about in terms of the likelihood it is of people to, if not accept, at least acquiesce to some of this ideology that in, you know, the Antigonids, for example, have to actually make the case that empire is an acceptable form of governing structure for societies, whereas the Seleukids don't have to do that to the same extent, at least not within a large chunk of their empire.
Maybe if Altay or Richard want to.
I'd like to throw in one further detail that binds together a couple of thoughts going back to Antiochus IV and the renaming, or not the renaming, actually the foundation of the polis of Antioch in Jerusalem. It's quite meaningful that Jason, the high priest, started the initiative and offered the king a few hundred talents for his permission to do so. So that, I think, is perhaps even the strongest implication of loyalty and of benefiting from showing loyalty to the king. And by writing one's name into the royal apparatus or the structure of royal rule at an elevated level under the king, but then as someone who does not only have the local rule of the high priest, but also the blessing and support and acknowledgement of the king. So as a win-win situation. And when you read the sources and other scholars have described it, and I think that I owe this observation to an earlier article of Eric Roon from the 1990s, it was not the foundation of Antioch that triggered revolt and resistance. On the contrary, it was very largely popular amongst the various classes amongst the priestly classes, and it's just a concatenation of unfortunate events, the escalation of violence. Let's remember that Jason tries to regain the high priesthood that Antiochus had sold to Menelaus, but he only tries to do it when he hears rumors that Antiochus had died in Egypt. These were wrong rumors. So on that initiative, or based on that information, he started a revolt, was very popular in Jerusalem, though then the king came back. The king, just having been humiliated by the Romans, he was quite angry and very brutally tried to crack down this insurrection. And this then started a sequence of events where on the Judean side, resistance ever more strongly gathered around the temple. And I think that is the main reason. So that's my view, that this was the main reason for a persecution of the cult, whereas there is another scholarly view rephrased in many ways recently as well, say by the author of the 2017 German monograph, Ben, you may help me. Johannes Bernhard. So he has resumed the view that the revolt is largely rooted in Antiochus's obsession with his own divinity and trying to, his attempt at imposing that all over the empire, a view that I do not share. So we do see a high level of loyalty to the king amongst the Judeans, and actually many Judeans, and even later amongst the Maccabees, quite surprisingly. So that seems to be more the norm than people have been willing to see, perhaps due to the bias that the Seleukids were weak, and that multiculturality and all the heterogeneity automatically must have led to disintegration. So I think that's a flawed view. So trying to bind the things together based on example.
What I was trying to say to Kyle, Altay, you just backed up. In other words, when Jason did this, when there was the stuff about Antioch, nobody said boo. That was not the cause of a problem. It's only, that's what I was trying to say about the violence begets violence, right?
Yes.
And even Altay, after that humiliation, that's what I was trying to say against Gruen, even after he came back and there was violence, still the persecution was not in earnest. There was still a time lag that nobody's ever explained. But it's still something like the sequence of violence. But the Antioch thing in itself did not cause a revolution, and I don't think it bothered anybody.
Yeah, in my chronological analysis, I try to trace the development from the revolt of Jason to the desolation of abomination in probably December 167. So we have a time frame of about 1.5 years where we have a gradual escalation and an ever-growing focus on the cult center in Jerusalem. Well, we are in an open discussion right now. Kyle, please.
I'm going to try and pick up some of the stuff that Richard has done on the sincerity of any of that. I don't actually disagree with anything that either of you have said, but how much that renaming was something that was a meaningful connection to the Seleucid Empire as a thing that Stephen was attempting to articulate, rather than just the achievement of direct benefits for the city and what those do to the population, or is it an actual connection to the Seleucids as empire? Or as an imperial thing? Is there a concept of Seleucid citizenship?
I think the answer to that is clearly no. And I think Stephen's paper to some degree points in that direction. I mean, this is exactly what Antiochus is trying to sort of get off the ground. This kind of idea of a Seleucid identity that can bind all people together. The fact that he has to do this, of course, or is attempting to do this, suggests that's lacking to begin with, and that Antiochus IV is acutely aware of that fact.
Well, some scholars say very decidedly, no, there was no Seleucid citizenship. Others say decidedly, yes. However, we have to look more closely at what is meant by citizenship. If you think of either Roman imperial citizenship, let alone a polis citizenship, then clearly Richard is right. There was not that type of Seleucid citizenship. And Richard, I also concede to you that, most narrowly, what was Seleucid? It was the ruling dynasty, the king and his immediate family. And people would not consider themselves as Seleucids in this narrow sense. Having said that, on the other hand, you have these dozens of cities and their citizens who would call themselves Antiochian Seleukians, and you have these tens of thousands serving in the royal army as Macedonians, not only in their own ethnic units, but a very high number would qualify for the phalanx. I think we can follow latest research on that topic. And that clearly creates a new kind of identity that goes beyond the traditional polis boundary and, at least shows some overlap, consent, admiration of the ruler who is above everything. It does not necessarily create the bond of loyalty, say, between a citizen in Seleukia in Pieria in Syria on the one hand and other subjects in Bactria or Media. So I do not think that, and that is something that, say, Roman citizenship would generate to some degree later on. So I hope that this helps a little bit to overcome the confrontation between, yes, there is citizenship, no, there is no citizenship. Stephen, you wanted to also respond to this view, and Susan, then we'll come to your question.
Yeah, I was just going to say that's why I try to talk about it in terms of identity. That's something a bit looser than citizenship, because I think talking about citizenship is it has such a specific meaning that I think we need to loosen the bonds to think about what that can mean, which is why I talk about identity. But yeah, the other thing I was going to say is I think we sometimes forget the obvious point when it comes to the vision of empire and the empire building, and the way that that comes is that so much of the Achaemenid precedent or the Antigonid stuff comes out of being rooted in a homeland, which obviously the Seleukids aren't, and I think that they're casting around looking for solutions to that.
I wonder if I could just interject something that might make a little bit of sense, but being a Canadian, when I travel and people ask where I'm from, I say Canada. I lived in Quebec for 10 years, and my Quebecer friends, that when they traveled and they are asked where they were from, they said Quebec. So they're Canadians, they're not, but they identify with Quebec above or first. So I think that regional difference, that's one small example, but that's probably what happened with the Seleucids and being such a large area.
Thank you. Susan, now your question.
Well, I was just thinking about how you build your iconography. You could have a flags, did they put flags up? Did they didn't ever put Seleukid as a country on their coinage, which is, we do that all the time now. And I'm just questioning, did they really want to be an empire, or did they just want to be the king and his court? They didn't really seem to want to have citizens that would be Seleukids. I've always wondered why they didn't put Seleukid on their coins.
So I think, again, it's helpful to look at the Romans as the real game changers. So first of all, in antiquity and much beyond, we are not yet in the time of the nation state. So the idea of the nation state did not exist. But the Romans were, to my knowledge, about the only, city state that developed into an empire which had, some similarities similarities to what modern nation states have. One clearly defined territory, one central government, at least at the top, with some diversification in the provinces, of course, and then also one army in which everyone potentially could change, could serve, one Senate. So we see an institutionalization that binds together an empire which developed under the Romans, but then was actually not continued. We see a much further disintegration when it went into the Middle Ages. And there was, yes, in late antiquity, everyone from Gaul to the Byzantine Asia Minor, they called themselves Romans proudly. And that was something that I don't think any of the other ancient or pre-modern empires had ever achieved. So when it comes to coinage, your specific example, either coins were issued from a ruler, a king, a dynast, a priest, high priest, and then it was something dynastic, something religious related to a central cult, or something under a polis authority. And with polis, actually, it's not only the Greek polis. We also find, say Tyre is a very important example, or Jerusalem at some points also issued coins. So you have either a city-state or a dynasty, but never kind of a nation-state as an entity. That would explain the lack that you have just observed. Kyle.
But yet it goes on for hundreds of years, with just this kind of fragmented little pieces of unity. And we talk about the loyalty of the citizens. Who are you loyal to? Just the king at the time?
Well, I think now there could be different layers of loyalty. And the normal thing was at least show loyalty to your local community, say the polis, to your local ethnos, even if it was not organized as a polis, but at least had a central cult or something like that. And then the king. And there may have been situations where you had to show loyalty to your king, who, however, may have been a vassal to a Seleucid king or the Ptolemaic king. So you might have served in the army of your king, but campaigning for the great king or later the Roman emperor. So different layers of loyalty, I think they were normal, not the exception, but the norm. And the major shift in world history, I always relate with the French Revolution and the push into the development of modern European nation states, which then spread all over the world also through European colonial impact. But Kai, you wanted to contribute?
I was gonna pick up on that point, but I was gonna try and pick up on something else and of that identity bit. But I do think there are attempts at the imperial level to create the opportunity for connection to the imperial family or to the royal family. And that rather than what you would expect in a modern state, there are elements of iconography that probably pervaded the empire to a greater extent than we have the material evidence to see, that are directly tied to the royal family. And that the images that we see are dynastic, but are replicated down to fairly low levels. And we if we have the extent of material culture that we have for the Roman Empire in the East, that we would see some of this reflected in the royal cults for the kings, but also in military regalia, in images on soldiers' shields, in the material culture that doesn't survive, would replicate some of the dynastic imagery because we've got hints of it elsewhere. So I think there was a creation to create a dynastic imagery, but it's very specifically tied at the highest level to the imperial family. And that those levels of loyalty that Altay have talked about replicate that to greater or lesser extents.
So I don't see any other hand raised. It's a good point to thank all of you, many of you who have contributed actively to the Seleukid Ideology volume, to the Seleukid lecture series, to this very event here. Cordial thanks to all of you and for showing support. The great thing is that our cooperation is not over with the publication of this volume, but especially Ben and I are very much invested into editing and also writing for the upcoming volumes. So please do expect Seleukid Perspectives Volume 2 in the next year. The title will be The Seleukids at War, Recruitment, Organization, and Battles. We have already several chapters, are still expecting a few more over the summer. If you think you have a near-ready paper to contribute and to submit really by the end of August, please do get in touch with Ben or me immediately. And even volume number 3, Seleukid Perspectives, Jewish Responses to Seleukid Rule, is in preparation and hopefully will see the light early in 2025. So with these words, I say farewell to you over and may you have an enjoyable summer break. But Ben is going to give you an outlook on the lecture series.
I just want to mention in terms of the perspectives that, you know, we see this as very open-ended and very collaborative. So even though we sort of have a vague idea about Seleukid Perspectives 4, right, which may be also on ideology following from some of the themes that we've been talking about today, we want to be very interactive with everybody in the field. And we're very open to ideas for chapters, for volumes, and also, and this is what Altay was getting to, also for the lecture series. if there are people who would like to volunteer. We have Graham Wrightson for September, who's going to be talking about a new perspective on the Battle of Pannon. We have for November, Alain Bresson on, I don't remember at this moment, Seleukid wealth with a question mark, or with wealthy Seleukids, I think that's what it was. So, but you know, again, you know, our whole thing is being interactive, is being collaborative, and we welcome all suggestions for chapters, lectures, volumes, as we proceed in this wonderful work. And thank you to everybody.